This is like 20 years ago. I was working on the move to you know, shove a tube up your nose and pull it out your mouth with this big promoter. And it was really important. This is the kind of promoter that could book 50 or 60 shows per year. Now, keep in mind, this is early days when I wasn't so good at regulating my intake. And then I kind of lick the tip, and he leans forward, and I put it up to my nose, and it leans forward, and I start sliding it in my nose. And he's like, what? And then it gets to the part where I open my mouth and I reach back with my fingers, and his eyes get big as saucers as he realizes what's about to happen. And then I reach back, trigger my gag reflex, and vomit 3 beers all over my chest. Yeah! Oh, you beautiful citizens of the internet, it's Tuesday night, and you know what that means. It has got to be go time for the show dedicated to farting around on the internet. It's Night Attack, beautiful people. The best, worst thing to ever come out of the internet. I'm Ryan Rushman, live in Austin, Texas. Joined, as always, by my inimitable co-host, out of OAK, it's JRY. What is up, Professor?
Yo, Ryan, a lot of things have been said about this show in the last week.
Yeah, and they're all true.
I know that it's a podcast.
Yeah. That happens on Tuesdays.
Tuesday night.
Yeah, yeah.
That one of us will die tragically in the next year. All of it's true.
Please don't play this at our funerals.
No. And whatever you do, don't play that I said, I defy you, death. I defy you for it to be me.
I'm watching Bonnie physically curdle up her body in discomfort at watching this happen.
I always used to do that. For whatever reason, I used to torture my mom whenever I would just like make jokes about like, anyway, I'm never going to die, Mom. Like I would just walk out of the door when I was a teenager, like, never going to die. No matter what I do, my consequences don't matter. I'm immortal. And she'd be like, don't say that. It's like, well, already did. Too bad.
Too late. Sorry.
So anyway, Brian, man, we got a dubious and honorific distinction today.
Yes, it's a dubious honorific as I believe it was Dubi Honorificus, who in ancient Rome once said, long live the vine, for on it wilts the flowers of 6-second videos.
And then there was Dubi Nosumstufficus, who said, I don't know, man, let's just see how it plays out. Together they were known as the Doobie Brothers. Long way to go for that.
So it's fine. It's fine.
Here's the deal, Brian.
Yeah.
It's been a long time. We like to be patient on this show. A lot of people think incorrectly that we're a bleeding edge internet show and that the newest, hottest crap on the internet is what we like to pay attention to. But that's not the case, really. When you really, I mean, Brian, really. Really, that's not the case. Like, we like to wait and see what's going to play out before we really want to honor it by giving it a night on the show.
Yeah, that's why we weren't sure the internet's going to work out, which is why the only domain we got is Farting Tuesday Night Show. reference to an old Saturday Night Live bit. Dude, all right, do you want to go straight in the bit, or you want to kibitz for a bit?
No. Well, here, I guess we don't need to set it up because we already got a million of them. I was trying to set it up so people could send stuff in. I guess they still could, right?
Dude, we have 50 vines queued up, which should last about 2 minutes.
Yeah, so here's the deal. What we're going to do later in the show is the first annual, so get ready for a lot more of these, Vine of the Year Awards.
The first annual Best Vine. Night Attack Awards. We're going to Hollywood.
Yeah.
The black tie affair.
The night that all the Viners have been looking forward to. Finally, we will honor them. And I'll tell you what, that first winner better be ready, because they're setting a real example for all the winners that are going to come after this.
That's coming up later. But in the meantime, we were going to gossip about all of our friends. We were talking about Darren Kitchen.
I went to go see Darren today.
Yeah.
I went to go see all the Hack 5 folks.
Yeah.
like most of the times I go to see the Hack 5 folks, it's because I needed something. I ran out of these things. Anyway, that's boring. Here's what matters. I went to Hack 5, and it was fun seeing everybody, and I got to catch up and hear a bunch of fun stories. And then they let me know that they – Brian, these guys are blowing up. Not only – they've always been a very profitable, entertaining enterprise, but, like, they're the most famous, like, brand name in hacker hardware in the universe right
Dude,
now.
No. Well, first of all, I seen it with my own two eyes when we went to DEF CON this year. It is astonishing. They have the biggest booth. They have the longest lines. People are super excited. Like they all bring burner phones because they're such high visibility targets for miscreants to mess with them. And they've got a couple of original devices. Very, very clever. The Wi-Fi Pineapple is basically a gizmo that it shoots out a Wi-Fi signal that all it does is say, yes, I'm that router you're looking for. And then devices connect to it and through it. And, we featured it on Hacking the System. I'd like to say that Hacking the System way ahead of all these other Johnny Come Latelys.
Absolutely. Of course, was on Mr. Robot. Yep. Earlier this year in season two.
That's the rubber ducky is the little, it looks like a USB thumb drive.
The rubber ducky thing. And that really, I guess there's going to be another, sorry, I was confusing it because Darren literally, while I was there, was on the phone with another very popular show that is structuring an entire plot around the use of Wi-Fi pineapples.
That's so amazing.
But no, you're right. It was the rubber ducky that was on Mr. Robot. And this week, on I believe the CBS program, The Blacklist, there was another mention of the rubber ducky. Brian?
I'm going to assume. I'm just going to assume. I haven't seen this. I don't know what it looks like, but I'm going to assume that it
NBC,
is.
NBC, not CBS.
Broadcast television, I understand that they probably can't be as nuanced as Mr. Robot, but I'm going to assume that they casually and accurately described it and made it just a small bit. I'm sure it's very subtle and hackers wouldn't bristle when they saw it.
You all right?
What's wrong?
Everything. Everything's wrong. Sir, I did as you ordered and isolated all the malicious code or remnants of it buried deep in our operating system. At first, I was confused. Our firewalls should have bounced it, but then I realized the only way we could have been breached was through social engineering, our physical access with a rubber ducky.
A what?
A keystroke injection attack platform disguised as a thumb drive. It would bypass all standard countermeasures by emulating a plug-in keyboard, reprogramming our host computer as if the hacker was manually typing in the code.
Still, the culprit would have to plug in a thumb drive.
Yes. Someone had to dupe an FBI employee with level 4 clearance. I spent the last 18 hours collating logins with the first appearance of the malicious code in order to figure out who got punked so we could interview the employee and nail that hacker.
And it was you. All
right. All right, pause. Give that man a goddamned Emmy for somehow making that sound remotely natural.
Oh, now, here's the deal. They went through all the positive things, right? You know, they mentioned the name. They read Wikipedia, so they know what it does. They worked it into the plot for a television show on broadcast. That's good. That's about as good as you could possibly hope, right?
Yeah, well, and keep in mind, Mr. Robot is, of course, well-beloved, by critics, but the exposure. I remember Teller saying that he had never experienced anything, even after they had Penn & Teller's bullshit on Showtime. They had never experienced the level of getting recognized just being out and about like they did after they guested on Fear Factor. He says, you cannot imagine what a difference primetime traditional broadcast television makes.
Now, listen, that was really great, right? And you got to imagine that Darren and everybody else at Hack 5 was very happy that it got honored the way that it did. However, if you were really making a little wish list to Santa, you might say it would be great if they could maybe involve the brand name in a clever or interesting way so people would remember exactly what they were going to search for.
Okay. Well, let's
play the rest of the clip. This is later in the episode.
All right.
Good. You do that.
I'll call back in 10 minutes.
By the way, for audio listeners, this is a woman now looking around her apartment, trying to find her laptop.
Golly, where is it?
Oh, finds her laptop with the rubber ducky in it.
Quack, quack, bitch.
Quack, quack, bitch.
Standing belly clap for you, sir.
Wow.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
Oh, that's amazing. That is amazing.
Let's just go. Come on. Let's just go back to that punchline. We just need that punchline one more time. It is just perfect.
Quack, quack, bitch.
So good. Dude, he's got to be floating on cloud nine, man. That's amazing.
No, that just aired this week, and then, they got, and now they're talking to a show that everybody in this, listening to this show, knows and loves about anchoring an entire episode around the pineapple. They are bawling right now. In fact, Darren was telling me, he's like, hey, listen, I would love, based on that episode, to run a sale where I could use quack quack bitch as a promo code. But they're still underwater based on Mr. Robot that they don't even have any more to sell.
Oh, that's got to be agonizing.
Oh, man.
I guess they could do what's funny is I'm immediately shifting into to panic scam stuff mode. I'm like, all right, listen, what they should do is they should sell pre-orders at a discounted price, guarantee your slot in line.
Yeah, I think to look at Darren was like, yeah, you know, it'd be nice if we weren't making the maximum amount of money that we can do right now. Like, it's like literally that's it. Because basically, if they run a thing now based on their supply chain, they can't do Christmas, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, you know, what are you going to do? They can still, they'll always be able to run quack, quack, the quack, quack bitch sale sometime in the future. Don't weep for Darren. He's going to be doing okay.
All right. Real quick. I want to know.
Do you buy this for somebody for Christmas?
Can we do a Twitter search for quote, quack, quack, comma, bitch? Sure. And maybe a Google search. I want to know if there's any in the wild comments about that. Because that's the part that blows me away.
Somebody
all right, we've
quack.
Plugged quack quack bitch into Twitter. We got
quack quack bitch. I was speaking to this Brazilian girl, and she was speaking porch of geese, and I was all like quack quack bitch.
Oh my gosh.
The blacklist exposed. Quack quack bitch. Wow.
Aram saying quack quack bitch is now one of my favorite quotes from Blacklist. Leave it to Aram to make. Apparently, Aram is like a bad boy on the blacklist. Oh.
Yeah, look at that. Oh, yeah. Aram.
Hey. Oh.
Yeah, no, people were really, you messed with the wrong Donald, bitch. Quack, quack. That's a very, about Project Veritas, the videos, the politically charged videos.
This was from like 2 weeks ago. Whatever, bitch. Fuck you. Fuck everyone. I hope you all die, including me. Quack, quack, motherfucker.
All right, I think we're pre-release of the blacklist at this point. Oh,
quack God. City bitch, quack city bitch. Just want to get that out of the way.
With the 10-10s, 50s in the web feet, bitch.
Okay, so I got a question for you. You know, Darren Kitchen was invited to a thing, and I was invited to a thing.
What?
And Justin was invited to a thing.
Oh.
And Jeff Cannata was invited to a thing. And Tom Merritt was invited to a thing.
Oh, wow. We're getting real. I was thinking that it was like some sort of like professional function. I'm like no, you're getting very, very into our personal lives.
I don't think I mean, you have not responded to the invitation.
I don't know. I'm not a big outdoors guy.
Yeah. Okay. So here's what I got. I was intimidated and scared by this, but Brett Rounceville emails all of us saying, "Sup, bros? Are you in or not?" And I click on a link, and it's Ragnar Trail, Zion, Utah. It's a 24-hour running thing where you run in shifts as a team, and you end up running hundreds of miles total. He wants to put together a team with Darren and Jeff Canada and Justin and me.
Oh, I didn't even know it was that. Oh, that's no. I'm definitely not responding to that.
What do you mean?
That's definitely a prank caller situation.
It's a 3 mile run, a 4.5 mile run, and an 8 mile run, and you have 24 hours to do it. Come on, that would be amazing.
But look at those people; they look.
I don't
so
know,
happy.
Man. Also, why are you bringing this up live on the air? I mean, I guess if you're gonna watch me squirm, it might as well be on the air. But it's like. Why are we doing this? I thought it was just like a camping thing and I was a no. Like now where everybody can watch me run. Like that's definitely a no. And I'm more in running shape now than I've been in the last 5 years. And well, it's still a no.
To be honest, that's exactly the reason why, is because this is our last chance. We will never be healthy enough to do this again. We're all going to be old next year.
Do you have an obese mouse in your pocket? What's with this wee stuff?
Wait.
All right, fine.
Wait.
But
you
see,
guys,
this is the thing. It's
I'm a 30-year-old who runs a 5K every morning. Like I'm childless. I have plenty of time to do anything like this. I just have zero interest in doing it now.
I think you just made a very compelling case for why you absolutely should do this.
I did not know it was a running thing. I thought it was a camping thing, and I was like, because Brett periodically has done these trips out to Utah where they camp and they have a good time, and like that's. Fine. I don't know. I'm just, that's not me. Like I'm, you know, I'm more of a, you know, I like to sit in the back end of dark, quiet bars. Like this is our, what happened to the Brian I used to know? His favorite hobby was sitting in quiet bars unbothered.
You guys already. Oh, for some reason, what are you doing? Why do you have this on?
Pace. Zero per mile.
I left my running app running from when I was running.
No way! And it just now decided
and it
to
just
chime
now
in.
Pointed out, it's like, well, you just finished your fourth mile. I mean, that's an omen, Justin. That quack quack, bitch. We gotta go to Ragnar.
You guys did just decide that one of you guys were gonna die this year, so.
Oh shoot!
Fair point. We got to avoid it. Yes. We got to avoid it. You, Brian, you want one of our hearts to pop running that Ragnarok trail?
Yeah.
I don't think so.
Well, no, totally. Totally. I mean, Tom's.
What's your pitch for this? Pitch me on why this is something that, even if it's something I don't want to do, we should do. Pitch me.
Get to hang out with Darren Kitchen.
I literally did that on a moment's notice today. Yeah. I drove 20 minutes north and I was hanging out with Darren.
You get to hang out with Justin. I mean Jeff. I was giving reasons for me to do it, not for you. No, come on, man. It's like this could be that wacky chapter in our life. It's like, hey, remember when we did something athletic? That was nutty.
That doesn't seem wacky.
So here's
that seems like we're all just gonna take obnoxious photos and post them on Facebook, and everyone's gonna be like, oh, look at them. We're gonna be like, oh, so exhausted, but so worth it. Like holding up our dumb medals.
Yes, that's exactly right. And
obnoxious. I don't like it.
Yes to all that, but also here's the biggest thing: is now every time. You go work out, you're not just working out to stay fit, you're training. And then you're like, oh, I've got a race coming up. I'm training for this race. That didn't do anything for you?
No.
Also, let's do it drunk. Let's do it drunk.
You're going to die.
No.
No, boo. You're not going. Never mind. I take it back.
Body uses veto power.
I don't know. I really don't know why I don't want to do it. To be fair, it's not like I have some long-standing, like, you know, my great-grandfather died on a running trail. Like, it's not anything like that. Like, there's no good reason why I would not want to do it. And like I mentioned before, I'm more in shape to do it than I've ever been before. It's I don't know. I don't know what it is. As soon as I saw that, I was like, I'm just going to hope everybody forgets that I'm on this email. And I just archived it. I don't know why. That was just my immediate reaction.
That's so interesting because like this is, I got more excited when I saw your name on the invite list. I thought like, wow, this was something that we've never done before. Like a working out thing.
With reason.
Yeah, I guess so. Well, I mean, you know, hey man, I'm just going to spice
and
things up.
And like, I like to run more than I like to do any other workout thing. Like I've never really been a weight training guy. I've never been a swimming guy. I've never done any of those other things that people do to stay in shape.
Is it the quote unquote competition aspect of it? Is it the fact that it's like ostensibly a race?
I guess I like running by myself.
You will be by yourself.
Then wait. What the fuck is the point of doing it with
you're
all of you?
You're all going out, but you're running separately?
It's a relay race. So there's a base camp, and there's three loops that have to be done. So one person goes, finishes their loop, comes back, everybody high fives, tell you you're the best person in the world, while the next person hauls ass and starts the next loop. And then he comes back, and then the next person goes on. And then between you guys, it's like it's a team-based thing. I think that's what it has me really pumped about it.
Sounds like the Relay for Life.
That's a cancer fundraiser.
Sounds like, what is it? Is it Take Back the Night? Take Back the Night? Is this Take Back the Night?
Take Back the Night. You guys need to Take Back the Night.
I mean, that's just
night
it.
Night Attack.
The idea that, you know, like, bye, see you in an hour, and then come back. You spend the vast majority of your time hanging out at base camp, and then each one of you, one at a time, start going like, ooh, I'm up next. I'm going to have to get ready to run. Here we go, guys. Ooh, look at me. I'm running. And nobody's looking, so I'm going to walk. And then, and then you keep running again. You're like, I did it, guys. And they're like, yeah, you're real great.
They're looking at their watches going, you ruined our time.
No. No, that's just that's just it. It's like, that's the other thing I like about it, is that it's such a mixed bag of athleticism that it's clear that nobody's doing this because they care about whether they're good at it or not. Like,
hold on. Wait a minute. You're telling everyone's going to go out to Utah and everyone's going to make time and effort and carve this out of their lives and their busy schedules to go do this and then not care how it goes?
Yeah. Well, that's the way it was when I did the triathlon. It was just about like, I wanted to finish it. I just wanted to finish it.
You're
yeah.
Like, I did this.
It was great. sorry, he's vomiting off screen.
See, you're ready already. You've got it down.
I don't know. Like, I just...
See, I didn't even know that you were actually running and that you were in good running shape, because I am in worse running shape by far now than I've been like just 2 years ago.
No, I wake up at 6 o'clock every morning and I go for a 5K run around the lake like for the last like couple weeks, but I don't talk about it because... Number one, here's a real thing.
Okay.
I don't talk about it because I know if I start talking about it, I'll stop doing it. Mm. Because I'll get the whatever brain chemicals that hit for taking credit for it, and I will stop doing it. It'll be a thing that I'll just stop doing. So I don't talk about it because that way it can just be a thing that I do. And I know that makes me weird and it makes me crazy, but it's just my system, right? And
sure.
And that, I don't know. Like, I really didn't know until you said right now that it was a running thing, And like, I don't know. Now I'm conflicted because now it's something that I know physically I could be able to do. But
yes.
For whatever reason, I don't want to do it.
Does it help that on the webpage it shows people wearing cool headlamps while they run? Around.
Yeah, you could be like all light trail.
Oh God, no! No, look at all those people that are taking it more seriously than I would be.
This guy's a
like,
ghost.
Look at all those. Look at all those serious ass faces doing serious things.
Are these people all dead?
They're
Is
ghosts?
That why they're see through? I don't think you guys should be doing this.
Oh my gosh. I think it would be fun, but that's fine.
No, now you've mentioned it on the show. Like, now it's gonna be a thing. If it were literally just us talking about it on email, it would be one level of embarrassment of me saying that I didn't want to do it. Now Brett's going to know, and Brett's going to watch this, and Brett's going to call me up. He's going to text me and say, hey, pussy, why are you being a pussy? Like, this is a thing now. That is there. And I didn't even know that it was a thing that I was avoiding because it was a, like, I'm
athletic thing. Yeah, yeah. What's my favorite part was the hiccup where, can you guess who on that thread? In fact, I'll toss to the chat room and say, who do you think out of all the names I mentioned was the one to point out, oh guys, I don't know. This is on Mother's Day.
Wait. Katana? Or wait.
Katana?
Jeff Katana.
Jeff Katana.
Jeff Cortana. Now on Windows 10.
Yeah, dude. Everybody's got it. Katana.
Katana. There we go.
Yeah. So I don't know. We'll see. It may not come together, but if it did, I think that I just adored it.
What are you so excited about? I mean, here's what I just don't know why. Well, no, I do know why. Because you were very. This is another triathlon, but this time it's with a bunch of people that you don't see all the time.
Correct,
right?
Correct. And also it's like, it's the kind of thing where it won't be about how fast you made it, but it's like, it'll just be fun to know that we did a thing, you know, like a wacky, bizarre thing of running, you know, 100 plus miles as a group or something. And also like Jeff and Brett were like super excited. They really enjoyed the other stuff. But yeah, Neshcom has it in the chat, wacky dad thing. Totally is.
My dad would be down for this. If you invited my dad, he might be interested.
You know what? Maybe we will. Is...
Oh, wait a minute. I didn't even put two and two together on that.
What's that?
Want to get out of the goddamn house.
Oh.
Yeah, it's all dads. It's a daddy relay.
Oh, now I get it. Now I get it. Because what I'm giving up is sleeping till noon, starting to drink, and then getting high and watching wrestling. That's what I'm giving up. You're giving up actually, like, raising children or raising infants.
Children are just a delight. They're precious lights that light up our life, and they're our future.
Bonnie there
is,
we go.
Bonnie
relay
is staring
for dad.
Daggers into that's Brian's just neck right now.
It's by the relay way. For dad. Now we've nailed it. Now we finally got to our core. It is everybody gets an excuse to get out of the house and go to Utah.
By the way, I've been adding up some vacation time. You know, Brian went out for like that show at your house.
Auntie Donna, yeah.
Auntie Donna, yep. You know, he was out there for that. And then this run, and then there was this, and then there was that. I'm like, I'm up to a month. I think I'm going to cash it in all at once.
The moment I asked Bonnie if it would work, she goes, that'd be great. I really look forward to taking a week vacation and doing whatever the hell I want.
Yeah.
Go ahead. I'll add it to the ledger.
Strength says that it is in 9 months, so I would still have time. So please, everybody inform Ashley that it's in 9 months.
Yeah,
I'll tell you what, Brian. There is one thing that is beyond controversy, and that is patreon.com/nightattack.
Heck yeah, man. Dude, patreon.com/nightattack is where you can join the ranks of the proud. You know, a lot of people, I don't know if you know this, Justin, a lot of people have jobs and they like our show because it's like hanging out with us. And then when the show's over, they're all like, well, that was less time than I have to fill. I wish that there was more hours of shenanigans and talk. Turns out there is. Turns out we've secretly done twice the programming. We haven't even been telling anybody because it's a pain in the butt to get to. You can't while you're working on the line in a Milwaukee brewery tasting all those beers. You can't open up YouTube and watch the pre-show and the post-show. And you couldn't until now because if you're a Patreon, if you just submit a dollar per episode and you can even set it to a dollar maximum per month, then you're only doing like a quarter an episode. You get your very own one-of-a-kind personal RSS feed that includes the pre-show and the post-show where all the secret, that's where we get naked. And we rub chests to butts.
You want to know what? Patreon not only is an amazing platform where you can support the show, but as a company, they're amazing. I was talking to Anthony at Patreon.
Anthony Privatelli?
Guys who handles all the folks that you know, have pages. And he was very keen on getting us live to the Patreon headquarters in San Francisco to do a show.
That would be amazing. That would be amazing.
And it
takes
place in 9 months on Mother's Day.
Sounds like I'm adding up some
more vacation time. There's one spot open. One spot open. I don't make a schedule, Brian. I don't make a schedule. But he said there's one spot, and it's only then where we could do a live show.
Well played, good sir. No, that would be especially delightful.
In all seriousness, they do want us to do a live show there. Anthony was serious about doing a live show, so we should probably figure that out.
Heck yeah. Also, I want to thank everybody who has made the jump and joined the club, become a patron. Enjoy your RSS feeds, people. I forgot all about this.
Yeah, it's time for the thing that I don't have the sound effect for, but it's time for the name chant segment of the show, nightattack.com.tv.
No,
moment.
Wait, hold on. You can get it.
Go
get it.
Come
on.
Just tell us to fill.
Fill some time, please.
Do you guys remember last week what happened?
This is a bit where we like to...
Don't explain the bit. Don't explain the bit in advance. No. Yeah. That's
hey, Brian, did you know that Ava Braun wore glasses?
Yes, but what many people don't know is she wore them in her panties.
What?
She said, yes.
All right, we got it. Here we go.
She said she thought her cooter was stank and she wanted to glass up the joints.
What?
That's what she used to say. And then she'd
wait. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the Night Attack new Patreon name chant corner hour.
It's an hour.
She put both of her legs in the air and said, let me get a good look at you, and just move the glasses up and down.
Hey, man, I don't know what you're doing right now, but Sloan, we're talking to you.
Sloan.
We appreciate you raising your donation.
Thank you for raising the donation, Sloan.
You've taken your first step a little wider, slow. All right.
Thank you, Sloan.
Thank you, Sloan. We hope that was weird for you.
But talk about last week. What was amazing?
Oh, yes.
Wait, what was
amazing? It was so amazing.
The guy last week, Flavor Toothpaste, whatever his name is.
It was Scented Laundry or something.
Oh, Laundry Scent.
We've already forgotten you. Sorry, dude.
It was a week ago.
Yeah, no, he definitely tweeted. He definitely tweeted that it made his day. That was amazing.
Yeah,
and it was his birthday, right?
It was his birthday.
Yeah, no, that worked out pretty good.
No, it was amazing. He had a birthday?
Yeah, he said he woke up and he put on his brand new headphones because it was his birthday. And he listened to his own name being all called out.
Best present
all.
Ever.
Hey, Laundry Scent,
wrong.
Stop trying to step on Sloan's moment.
Yeah, dude,
jerk.
This is about Sloan. What are you doing, Laundry Scent?
Okay, let's all say happy birthday, Sloan.
Happy birthday, Sloan.
Happy birthday.
All right. I'm not participating. I'm protesting. Boo. Hey, do we have? I think we have a new Cogswell joint.
We do. It is.
Oh yeah. If you and you know
yeah,
what this is good. This
play
is good.
So I can get more ice in my.
Yeah. Real quick. Pre-show, post-show. This was a post-show bit when we played the clip from Raid Select.
Yeah.
And then this became a song from Stephen Cogswell. So this is the kind of stuff you get to participate in if you're an actual patron. I'm gonna try to look a little more stoned.
Oh, sure, you got a suicide. You said, give me a spritz of all of them or I'll punch you in the
ding, ding, ding. Winner for you. Jump, angry bees, lots of bees from your dick and testes.
Old guy reference now, like
I mean, that's legitimately the first mashup between the Hamster Dance and Come As You Are about ejaculating bees.
The dude's a genius. How is he not the most popular musical artist of all time, Stephen Cogswell?
Get his new album.
He's so goddamn good.
Get his new album, StephenCogswell.ca.
Yeah. Oh, my God. So good.
I forgot how good that was.
Oh, man. Hey, by the way, big shout out to Waffleophagus, who's trying to make it all about himself today because it's his birthday.
Oh, wait, is that what we do now? We're like the stripper DJ at Chuck E. Cheese's. Hey, just want to give a shout out.
Look who's going to get a birthday today. Get out of the ball pit, you snot-nosed piece of crap. Here comes Melinda Mouse with a pie. And next to the stage, get ready, it's Boris Bear. By the way, that's 2-for-1 ball pit. 2-for-1 ball pit for the next song.
And let's see those tokens, people.
Oh, come on, don't be stingy. Get them tokens out.
God, I feel like I should just do an album about what it's like to go to a Chuck E. Cheese birthday party. It is such a desperate and sad occasion.
Yeah, it's you know, they serve beer. Chuck E. Cheese.
Wait, really?
Yeah.
You just like, it's so telling because you'll look around and there'll be a couple of people there, like adults there with their arm on the table and their head on their arm. And they're just like, And then, like, the kids are all just running around and beating each other up. And
man, all like, I care about is that nobody's sitting in a puddle of another kid's pee. Like, that's all. I'm like, go for it, kid.
That's because you haven't been on the ball pit.
Oh, geez.
They don't let adults up there. That's where the pee is.
I want to be where the pee is.
Who else seen the pee? Say yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, by the way, in all seriousness, a big shout out to Waffleophagus, one of the most hardcore of the hardcore. So happy birthday to you, buddy.
Hell's
hey,
yeah.
Brian.
Yeah.
Vine. It's about time that we recognize the best of the best.
Dude, you know I got a lot of followers on Vine. We should post Captain Morgan bits on Vine.
We wanted to do Captain Morgan bits until we fought about what to name them. And then we just stopped doing it.
We were like, eh. So let's talk about stripper DJs that talk Chuck E. Cheese's instead. All right, hey, we got to pick the world's best Vine. So let's throw us one, Maestro.
Well, it's not just we have to pick the world's best Vine. This is
the first annual.
The first annual. Yeah.
Best Vine.
Best Vine.
Yes,
ever.
We have to
and
give our award.
By the way, as an award for the best Vine, we'll be giving away these contender pins, which are available right now at thecontender.us and bit.ly/votingpin. Use offer code DIAMOND for 10% off.
Ooh. Now back to your regularly programmed show. All right, well, here's our first contestant.
Here we go. That's pretty good. One of the classics of Vine trickery, especially in the old days. It used to be that you couldn't do editing and stuff, so it was all about like clever edits of letting go at the right moment and stuff. So it was a skill thing, but you got a skateboarder doing a flip-a-do,
and it looks like he's
doesn't seem like it jokes about a racial stereotype.
Yeah,
though.
Yeah.
I'm gonna demerit it for that.
But it is our de facto best for right now.
Yeah, best for right now.
New champion Wu.
So, Brian, how would you explain our new champion Wu, same champion Boo philosophy?
Well, each contender can either be the new champion, in which case we'll say and think Wu.
Wu.
But if it fails to usurp, then we'll say and think Boo.
Boo.
Yeah.
Oh. Deep.
Take it from me, the...
The D-Man.
Save it for the Vines. All right. Yeah. Here is our next one from Joe Fleming. This is silent.
Wait, what did I just miss? What just happened?
The caption is not cool, dude, on Segway. This is from the
Is that Usain Bolt?
I Maybe. I believe this is from the 2012 Olympic Games. No, this would
no,
be from
that's
2014.
A new that's a new segue. Some dude just barrels over somebody at what I assume is the Olympics.
So wait, he's a cameraman? Was he just doing tracking shots on with a camera?
Yeah. No, he fell over and
and that is Usain Bolt, the fastest man in the world that just got ran over by this.
All right, new champion Woo. New champion Woo.
All right.
Hey, by the way, can I just say something about the D-man?
Yes, of course.
The D-man is a much funnier impression now that I know a lot more people getting divorced.
It's a lot of material to work with, right?
Like a lot of like whenever anyone's like, I don't know, I think we're actually gonna file papers. I'm like, oh, good move, but you got another 20 to get to me, the D-man.
I recently started CrossFit. I'm excited. I met Janice. Maybe she's 34 coming up.
All right.
I don't want to. All right. We don't need to go into the specifics. We don't need to go into the specifics. But there is somebody that we both know that is in the process of getting divorced. And Brian just goes to me and says, hey, so you know, name redacted. You know, and it's like immediately I knew everything. He didn't even get to the impression.
He's like, well, you know, it's a complicated life.
All right,
next.
Here's number three.
Usain Bolt.
This is from Kamiko in Japan.
Not bad. I mean, it's an impressive feat of. Homoeroticism.
It's two students in a high school. They are like pulling each other.
They're trying to pull down each other's pants so hard that they become the human centipede. They're the human scorpion, which is a delightful feat.
That looks great. It's not as funny as trying to ruin a premier athlete with a segue. So I'm gonna say same champion boo.
Yep, same champion boo.
All right, here's contestant number four. This is from ICU. Baby,
you can call me Queen Bee. Wait, is that Auntie Donna?
It is.
You can call our own ICU made this one day ago.
Really great. Good way to pander to our tastes. Also, not as impressive as watching a literal walking legend have his career in jeopardy because of some jackass on a Segway.
All right. Well, then that's going to be a same champion boo.
Redshirt says, aren't vines dead? No, they're not. In fact, we are right now holding the first annual Best Vine Award.
Yeah. So. No, that's how you know they're not dead. Come on.
Far from dying.
Yeah. Besides, all right. Vine's Katrak will always live in our heart.
Here's the next one.
I love J.J. Abrams movies. That one movie where Lindsay Lohan is a twin. The Parent Trap? Yes. And Inception. I love J.J. Abrams movies.
That one movie where is Lohan pretty is great. The Parent Trap? For the audio listeners, there's a visual beat with each of those phrases. You get a lens flare. You get her talking to herself in the mirror, and you get holding the Vine program up to the... It's perfect. It's perfect.
No,
but
it's not.
It doesn't involve...
This is the worst grading rubric. We've
international
done on a game yet.
Treasure. Like, go back and watch. Let me see Usain Bolt again.
Okay, all right, here.
I mean, he's minding his own business, and then
as if the man on a Segway was like a bad guy in wrestling. He just sneaks up right behind him and then runs his Segway right into the knees of the premier athlete.
And as if he's playing for Manchester soccer.
United?
Yeah, Manchester United. He's selling the fall so that the ref will red card him.
By the way, I would have went 30 minutes of you trying to fill in an actual soccer club's name. The Manchester Fighting.
I thought it was United, but I wasn't sure. But man, I used to play the hell out of FIFA back in college.
Oh, a FIFA man?
Yeah, and what's funny is all I remember of that are the players that were popular in the mid 90s because it'd be like a good ball, good long ball, Klinsmann, Weggerly. Weggerly! like,
are you having a stroke?
That's what it sounded like in the game.
All right, here's our next contestant. This is from.
Oh, there's a fucking car in my engine. Fuck!
All right, so
this is a hunting boy. He's wearing camouflage.
He's getting attacked by a raccoon.
And
looks
a raccoon flies at him.
It looks as though somebody threw the raccoon at him.
Oh my god! Yeah, from out of nowhere.
Look at his body. That's not jumping. That's throwing.
Hey, Brian.
Yeah.
I'm give that new champion Woo.
Wow. So long,
the
Usain.
Physical comedy is better than the Usain Bolt one.
Yeah. Wow. All right. In. All right. Congratulations. New champion.
That's from Colton Hansmeier.
Woo. Waggly.
Here's number 7.
Waggly Stoichkov.
Hey, dude, watch this. I want to try. Hey, dude, watch this.
That's the blocking out the haters kid, right?
It is. Brendan Bowen. And so he's like doing a fart sound.
He does a fart and then he appears to shit his face.
And there's like poop on his face, yeah.
That's some genius, but nope, sorry. Not as.
Yeah, no, I mean, it, listen, kid, it's real funny, but you're not blocking out the haters. And like, are we at this point? Are we at the point
where we interrupt a Vine to shout what other Vine we want him to be playing instead? We're like, yeah, play Blocking Out the Haters.
Blocking
like,
Out
skip
the
to
haters!
The best part.
Do Charlie Bubba finger.
Haters. Are we demeriting for the I'm Two People thing? Because that became a huge Vine like trope, right? The one person playing two people thing.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if we should. That seems like endemic in the. That's part of the.
Pastiche. I mean, I'm just saying it has to be really funny to get over the fact that it is that trope.
Yes.
Right?
Agreed. Okay. Agreed.
Well, here's number 8. This is from Bo Burnham.
I just want to say sincerely that this app was fun for 3 months and then it sucked dick. Have fun in hell. I just want to say sincerely that this
5 days
app
ago.
Was fun for 3 months and then it sucked dick. Have fun in hell.
Wow. Did you see that the guy that created Vine just tweeted in all caps randomly? He said, "Don't sell your company."
Oh, Jesus, really?
Yeah. like, not at replying, no links, nothing. Just all caps screaming, "Don't sell your company."
I mean, probably got some good money for it, right?
Yeah. Probably. But it's like, you don't get too many bites of that apple, though.
But that's a boo. We're going to
say. Oh, yeah. No. Yeah, sorry,
I'm
Bo.
Sorry. I'm sorry.
You get the boo, Bo.
Bo Burnham is the new Steve Martin, but he's not going to win this here contest.
Right, here's number 9. So the caption is, "When her parents aren't home," and she loves memes.
Oh, is somebody getting dressed up as Dat Boy?
As Dat Boy, he puts on a Zentai suit and a frog mask and takes his unicycle out for a... Out for a
yeah, game. All right. That's fine. No, she loves memes. You're going to fuck her, Dat Boy.
Sorry, oh hi, Mark. More like
Oh shit, oh, what hi, up? Mark. I'm a meme!
All right.
Hey,
but by the way, did we call it on peak Harambe or what? Like, how over Harambe is the world?
Well, it went post-irony, right? It didn't even make it to Halloween.
Oh, yeah, it didn't. That's crazy. All right, here's number 10 from Ricky.
Nope, next.
This is
not even going to bother to explain.
It's,
by the way, all right, or Dr. Fane just says, R.I.P. Harambe, dicks in. Put him back in.
Hey,
put him back in, folks.
I'm always game for a good Eurobeat joke. All right, here's number 11. This is from Tiki.
When you realize you're a bird.
That's you. So what you see here is what you get. It's you. Nice. That's you. So what you
see here is what you
get. It's you.
I mean, listen, no one's more susceptible to bird shit than me, but fuck this parrot.
Susceptible to bird shit. You're like allergic? You break out in awes when you, when
no,
you
but,
see
yeah,
bird
man,
shit?
Man, you've been to my apartment. You see how susceptible to bird shit this apartment is?
True.
It is constantly under
True
siege.
Thing.
All right,
look, let's lightning round this.
If he had gone on me, I was planning to go in completely, drop the sword down.
Is that a real guy?
If he had gone on me, I was planning to go in completely.
Oh, yeah, this is the guy.
I'm sure that's a mashup of memes, and it's an Overwatch. Move!
Next! Dick.
He took a samurai sword on a light rail, and it's stupid and dumb and funny. All right, this is Chris's...
All right, fuck! I don't want to see any Overwatch anything. Overwatch is suddenly disqualified.
Yeah.
Skip 10 forward.
Yes, 10 forward. Okay. Go 10 forward.
All right, here's number 23.
Like this we're from... hanging with Guinan on the Enterprise.
The caption says,
that's me at every college party I ever went to. I have never felt more in tune with that dog than what just happened right there. Brian, that's my new champion. Woo!
All right, I'm back in your play. Next. We got a dog telling people to stop playing guitar. Stop trying. Stop caring.
All right, here's number 24. This is from Eliza.
I don't want to run.
Everybody!
This is a cell phone video of in charge of people taking
communion. That means somebody was vining during communion, which just makes it even better. All right, this is my new champion. I'm sorry.
There we go. New champion. Woo!
That's amazing.
All right, here's 25. This is from Brisk God.
This is an otter scratching its back sexily. I've never wanted to fuck an otter before.
Really?
And I don't now. So stop the otter.
Next.
Very adorable.
Yeah, it's a boo.
All right, this is number 26 in our lineup. It's from Von Dylan. Von Dylan.
Is that for real?
No, it can't be.
I. How can that be fake?
Oh no, that's movie just magic? After Effects, right?
Yeah, that looks really fake. So, like, she's blowing out her sweet 16 candles.
Yeah,
on
no, there's like a lag of realization that happens in real. Can we just to set our palate? Can we see an actual flaming shot fail? Just type in flaming shot fail. Because there's always that little bit of denial.
We could see the one moment that I lit my face on fire.
No, that's fine. We've seen that a lot. Look at this. Flaming shot fails 5 minutes of this. Oh, God. Oh, God. I can watch this all day. All day.
He's not wearing a shirt.
All day. All day. They wait too long. The glass is now molten hot. Oh,
No.
Hey, let's go back to shots. Can we just go back to shots?
Everybody! All right, just one more flaming shot fail.
Everybody! Oh, gosh. Okay.
Oh, wait. We're going to more flaming shot fails? No.
I mean, it's like this.
No.
We're playing a game.
No, one more. One more flaming shot. Maybe this is
how,
right.
Like, morally opposed
right,
to it. Bryce definitely
closed
that immediately.
So fast.
No, but Bryce, maybe this. I mean, they're smart.
They can't be all that bad. I'm sure this next one will be like, oh,
this next one's
going to
be better. Yeah. By the way, for everybody listening, blue flame coated that man's lower jaw.
Oh, God.
Oh God! No! He breathed fire!
Okay, and the impulse to run away from the fire is the part I don't get. It's like it's on your body. You're not going to look. Take it from me. Hi, I'm Brian Brushwood, receiver of second-degree burns, live on stage while performing a magic show. Don't embarrass yourself. Don't become an animated GIF. Stand there and take it like a man. You're gonna burn just as bad either way, but at least we won't be laughing at you on the internet.
This is your advice to drunk 19-year-olds in a dorm room getting hammered for the second time in their lives.
Well, and plus it's like they're wearing a beard of blue flame, like the next bad guy in Pirates of the Caribbean, and it's like they're wearing a shirt. Just take the shirt and cover it and smother. And get a brother.
Let's go back to safety. All right. Let's
yeah. I mean, but Bryce, hold on. Before we go back to Vine, can we just see one more?
Yeah.
I'm sure
somebody reacts smartly.
All right. Someone is also okay. So they've made the shot.
See. Okay. Now every second they're sitting there waiting, That is getting, that glass is getting hotter and hotter.
Yeah, and that's what happens when they screw up, right?
Oh, they faked each other out.
Oh, God! Oh, no!
No, no, the house is on fire! The house is on fire! The linoleum floor is on fire!
All right, no, here, this guy's got it together. He's fine. He's fine.
Just to make sure, do our due diligence. He's doing it by himself. He's French-Canadian.
Oh, no! This guy had the right idea! He was gonna do like a flaming car bomb! He was gonna drop it at the Guinness, but instead he just spilled it all over his hands! It was such a bad idea!
No. Look.
Wait, hold on. Maybe we can just change the bit a little bit, right? Right? What if you just narrated the next one?
All right. Maybe we're screwing it up.
Bryce, you narrate the next one.
We're the ones screwing it up.
We're screwing it up. That's on us. Bryce, you just narrate as if this were radio. Sure. What's happening?
All right, so there's a gentleman at a bar. He's got a shot. It's already been lit, and he's got a dark drink, like a soda maybe next to him. He downs it. His mouth is on fire. It's his lips are on fire. He's batting at it like a monkey.
It's not so bad.
That one wasn't so bad. Oh, yeah. But it's still on fire. Oh boy. Oh gosh.
The table.
That wasn't as good as I thought it was going to be. Let's go back to the vine.
All right, this is number 27 in our document from Alex's vine.
How's the fishing?
Just wait, help me bring it in.
How's the fishing?
Just wait, help me bring it in.
Is that a naked person?
How's the fishing?
I can't tell.
Wait, help me bring it in.
Yeah, he's definitely naked.
He's full-on naked person naked. Tackling
dude,
a dude standing in a canoe.
That is a like, Goldberg-level spear. That it goes like from a dude in a canoe into the water with a naked man. A
how's
human missile.
Wait, help me bring it in.
I like that you can hear his footsteps.
How's the fishing?
Wait,
like,
he's,
I love the mocking tone about the fishing.
By the way, people are saying fake and gay. Maybe gay, but like, I don't care if it's fake. That's amazing. That's so good. In fact, I don't care if it is both fake and gay in the highest order. That's
agreed. Right? I'm gonna call a new champion. Woo! Champion. There you go.
All right, here's number 28 in our document. This is from Simply Silvio's. Do interims like to
party? And it looks like it's
all right,
dancing. Next. I can't relate to that. I've never put an inchworm on my monitor. What kind of freak of nature does that?
All right, here's 29. Jake.
That's not real.
That is so real. Well,
it goes like out of tune.
Yeah, no, I'm moving along.
Yeah,
Nope.
Okay.
Faking straight.
Yeah, too straight.
All right, here's number 30. This is from John Mala. Mankind stands no chance.
Run.
So it's a man on a beach with a closed umbrella, throwing it like a spear at an open umbrella.
And then suddenly it is a buffalo herd of stampeding, windswept umbrellas.
No, same champion, boom.
Same
sorry.
All right.
It's pretty good. I love the jabbing idea.
Why would he think he was doing? All right, here's number 31 from Trench's Vine. Oh, it's another Trench. This guy does all sorts of
stuff with his dog, apparently.
Stuff with his dog. His dog is
pushing. Yeah, we already seen. Hey, yeah. Bryce, we've had a couple no's in a row. What do you say we just take another flaming shot?
I mean, you never know. I'm sure they
can't. Maybe you can just cleanse our palate and get another flaming shot video just going.
Right, like, sure. Here we go. This is,
The table's on fire.
The table's already on fire.
And the guy's unsure if he should grab it and throw it on his face, which he does. What was that?
The shot glass is in completely encompassed in fire. He grabs it
and then throws it at his face.
Throws it at his face, thinking. Meanwhile, he's spreading the fire. Oh
yeah.
Oh,
all right.
Boy.
Oh, so, Brian, I'm sure you know, in the scale of fire, when it's blue, it's what degrees? When it's yellow,
it's blue, it's true. If it's yellow,
it's mellow.
It's mellow.
Let it mellow.
If it's red, you're dead. If it's white, that's too bright.
That's for the night.
If it's green, the copper's clean.
Yep.
If it's purple...
Nothing rhymes with purple.
Nothing rhymes with purple.
All right, here's number 32. This is from Dank Memes.
Why? Nope, not interested. Already don't care.
Why?
We actually watched this video, I think, in a pre-show, but someone has put Waluigi's nose on this man.
Yeah, it's a.
All right, here's 32 from Gray Jones.
It's just the.
Shit!
So it's the GameCube opening logo.
Shit.
Yeah.
But it's somebody falling over and spilling their big gulp or their gigantic Slurpee all over the floor in front of a 7-Eleven. Nope, same champion boo.
All right, here's number 34.
Brian, we're really in the doldrums here. I feel like we're...
Wait. We're going to be good. Beautiful morning. Oh man,
very specific.
Such potential.
No, because there's way better videos with that song too. Like there's like that whole Kanye West thing. It's I don't know.
All right, here's Chance Hill.
Oh. How do you run this thing?
Move the sticks.
It's not bad. Not bad. We can keep on going. It's just a dude going crazy with a bulldozer.
He runs over a full-size tree.
Next.
All right.
I mean, maybe it's for the best what's happening to this app. The more we watch...
I'd hate to say it, man. I might go back to Bo Burnham's Vine being the best. It certainly is feeling...
It turns out that Bo Burnham was like the Jacob Marley of this bit, just warning us of what was to come at the very beginning.
All right. This is number 36. This is from Sailor B.
A bunch of pinatas.
Duh.
I like to.
Yeah, you know what?
It's
fuck Vine.
Rice on a cracker.
Fuck Vine. Fuck this format.
They're minions pinatas, and then there's a SpongeBob pinata. Y'all have to describe these. This is an audio heavy audio.
Yeah, no, you gotta watch this one. I mean, listen. Nesh, are there descriptors or you just got links there?
I only have links here.
Yeah, and there's no way he could have previewed all these.
No, I know. I'm not asking for that. I'm just curious if there was any way that we could just look for hot things. You want to know what? Bryce, up to you. Random number generator.
Okay.
Let's pick three more.
All right. We're going to do number.
Actually, just pick one more. I have a proposal.
Can we watch it three times?
No. Pick one random number. What's your random number?
I'm going to go with 45.
Okay, wait.
Not clicking it yet.
Justin?
Yeah.
Number 45 is our official pick for the best,
Vine ever.
The first annual best Vine ever.
The first annual best Vine ever. We will decide it. We have now decided that our previous champions, null and void.
All disqualified.
All right. 45.
Ladies and gentlemen, our official award winner, number 45, the best Vine this year. Yes! Oh my god! fucking Bryce just acted like he actually won the actual award. He was
I know, I swear to god. Like, somebody winning the Stanley Cup has not reacted as expressively as Bryce just did for this Vine.
This is the
he jumped right the hell up.
It's the Shiva dog dancing to Toto's Africa.
It's pretty great, actually. I need this animated GIF in my life.
I'm down with this. I'm down with it. There we go. Hey, Brian, we've crowned the first annual Best Vine Award.
Huzzah! Yeah, ta-da.
Information we can only say, quack, quack, bitch.
Hey, man, I feel like it's time for us to move into a little bit of Diamond Time.
Hey, Brian, Diamond Time is where you can shout out your projects right right here on the show. If you would like to, you should go to diamondclub.reddit.com, which is where you can find that old sticky post. Right there at the top, it's in green. Today, our first Diamond Time submission is from I Am Pierce. Hey there, Diamond Club. This is a creative music outlet for my brother Jovi and I, Nick, from Rochester, New York. Why listen? Why not, fucko? Just looking to share our music with the DC fam and are always looking for some feedback on our instrumentals. Check us out at soundcloud.com/user-Jaden. That is J-A-N-D-N. Or facebook.com/Jaden Music Production, spelled the same way. Our SoundCloud link is YOLO420.com/JN Swag. Or on Facebook, it is YOLO420.com/JN Book.
Sea Grunter writes, G'day, Diamond Group. Take two. G'day, Diamond Group. I'm an admin at an 18-plus gaming community called the Unreal Aussies. There's a big WoW guild, not my kind of game, and we play maybe 15 or so other games on a regular basis. I personally am partial to Heroes of the Storm, or as Brian Brushwood calls it, Running Away, the game. I mainly head up to a group that plays classic older games once a week as well. Anyway, PAX Australia is happening this week, and we'd love to meet some more like-minded people. We also play some tabletop and go out for food in our cities around the country as well. Check us out at unrealaussies.com with YouTube and social media links on the site. Also, feel free to contact us and hit us up at PAX. Cheers, Sea Grunter.
And of course, M. Kapelke says, hi there, Diamond Club. This project promotion is for anyone interested in the British sci-fi series Doctor Who. It's a fan-made series that you probably aren't aware of, but it was quite popular several years ago when it was in active production. You see, back when I was in university, this is long, Kapelke, Jesus.
This is like six paragraphs.
Along with a group of like-minded friends, decided to try our hand at producing an original radio play and short film since we were all Doctor Who fans, and what better way to learn how to make stuff than to make our own adventures in time and space. The end result, between 1999 and 2005, we produced over 50 adventures for our own ninth Doctor, played by my good self, long before there was an official one in both audio and video format. Our productions were notable at the time for not failing into the usual traps that fan productions did. Chiefly, we treated this as if we were producing an actual mainstream version of the show.
Let's let it speak for itself. The website is btrproductions.com. Play anything.
This is a wiki.
Oh.
I thought they had episodes. Because they do, but it's like...
Oh, it's in wiki format.
It's in wiki format. Oh, here we go. We've got a trailer of something.
We'll find a play button.
Meteorologists claim that this is going to be one of the hottest summers on record.
This is a trailer.
The likely cause of the increases is the increase in the industrial pollution. The Minister for the Environment has announced...
This is from CSIR 2001.
Have discovered chemical mutations. It's a different time.
Mr. Gutnick. I've just got word from our mayor now.
Williams? What is the matter, mister?
You've heard those news reports about that mutated water that's going around, yes?
How's the work coming along?
They are grinding to a halt. Team Marie's militia is suddenly against the idea of using our services.
All right, so here's the deal. M. Kapelke continues, the reason why I'm posting this is we have several productions that are not finished, and we're looking for people to help us with audio editing and sound design. If anyone in Diamond Club is keen to help us finish these incomplete audio adventures, feel free to get in touch. It'd be nice to finally bring an end to a journey of a group of Aussies that were started nearly 20 years ago. Hey, true story. If you have ever asked either Brian or I of how you get into podcasting and you want to learn just a way to bring sound design to something that is already there, this is a great way to do it. So go ahead and get in contact with M. Kapelke there on the Reddit.
Yeah, man.
Wait, hold on. There's four here that we need to get to this last one.
All right.
Because this man deserves our... I have no idea. You all as a community have made me sad that this did not make the top three. Spearmint Nitrate writes, hi, I'm Spearmint Nitrate, professional weird internet person. You may know me from the animations at the start of 80% of the popular podcast Night Attack. Thanks for the support and laughs, blah, 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 first time, long time, etc., etc. I made a design If you want to wear it on your body, you can. Go to spearmintnitrate.com. Poster coming as soon as I can work it
Holy
out.
Cow.
Help of a Patreon, patreon.com/spearmintnitrate.
I am buying both of these t-shirts. I'm going to buy the men's and the women's. And
so the design is like a little clubhouse that has like all a bunch of different people who've been on the show, Brian and Tom and Bonnie and Tom and Veronica. And then there's another one that's Brian and Justin's cartoon heads. These are both super, super.
Dude, this man deserves your love and support. What's the URL again, Justin?
That is spearmintnitrate.com. Spearmintnitrate.com.
I am super stoked to buy a t-shirt.
I mean, listen, what can we possibly say about Spearmint Nitrate? He produces like professional level animations to us for free. And has told us vociferously that he doesn't want to get paid for it or else it would feel like a job. So it's like, this man creates so much for us. If you enjoy his work, like I enjoy his work and Brian enjoys his work, then please feel free to support his Patreon as I do and buy his shirts because the man's a goddamn genius.
Yep. Hold on. I'm almost done ordering my shirts. Let's do the movie draft minute.
Welcome to your Movie Draft Minute presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the week of October 31st, 2016. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. Fall is upon us and so is the second week of the draft. Has anything changed? Not a whole lot. But you know what? We still have a long way to go. Let's check the scoreboard and see who's on top. Milongo AE, Mikey Newman, Team DTNS, and Brian Brushwood are all tied for third place. Still winning for the first film. Joshua Romeo's in second place with Inferno bringing in $14.8 million a week. And in first place, a whopping $39.7 million a week, it's Rich Gates. And that is your Movie Draft Minute for the week of October 31st, 2016.
I mean, so there's no doubt it's going to be Tom, right? Is there any way it's not going to be Tom?
Jeez, Inferno. I'll tell you what, that one turned into a David S. Pumpkin for me.
Yeah, that was problematic because that needed to be a bit of a breakout hit because otherwise Dr. Strange has to make Avengers money.
Well, I'll tell you what. I mean, at least the reviews are there for Dr. Strange.
Yes.
Right?
That is
so
correct.
So basically, I need Dr. Strange to be the highest grossing movie of the winter when there's a Star Wars movie out.
Yeah, well, which is not impossible because this is uncharted territory, but I'm of the strange opinion that Rogue One, I think, actually has a chance to do surprisingly well because Rogue One is the first Star Wars movie since A New Hope, the first one since 1977 that in no way requires that you know anything about Star Wars or that
you keep saying that, but then they keep showing Darth Vader in the trailers.
Yeah.
But everybody knows who Darth Vader is.
Okay, but that would go against what he's saying.
Well, no,
right?
Like you have to. No previous knowledge is you know, it's not part of a story. It's a wholly self-contained. Like all you need, you know, you just go there. You cannot even know that Star Wars is a thing and sit down and watch Rogue One and be in the exact same place as with A New Hope. Where it's just like, well, I guess there's ships and laser swords and stuff. All right.
Sure. Hopefully. I guess, I think that it's a little bit more interconnected to things than that, in my opinion. But we'll see, right? Like we'll see where it lands. But I think it's going to dominate. And I think you're right. Like literally, Doctor Strange needs to be the Matrix for me. Like it needs to just be this cultural phenomenon that everybody is talking about and everybody needs to see because it's like this insane, your eyeballs melt when you see it experience, which the reviews are positive. I don't know if they're that positive.
Well, and there's the other boost in that apparently this is a, you know, if you're into 3D or if you consider watching something in 3D, this is a must watch in 3D versus, you know, like, I don't even want to think about 3D. I'd rather have it be bright than 3D. And so then that way you get bigger box office.
I got into a little back and forth on Twitter with a bunch of people last night. Do you think that Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them will be a good movie? Take away how much money it'll make, right? Do you think it will be a movie that you walk out and say, oh, that's great, I like that?
No, it'll be a cute movie, I think.
Like,
oh, that's cute.
That you will enjoy it or not. Because it is my opinion that in watching all the trailers and the commercials, that I think it will be a boring, bad movie.
I don't know. I mean, you're talking to a guy that lost interest in the books halfway through and then tried watching the movies and lost interest in the movies halfway through. So okay. I don't know that I'm going to be your best litmus test. But from what I understand, there's a huge amount of affection that people have. You know, it's a generational thing. Like, oh, I grew up watching Harry Potter. It's like I'm back there again, kind of, but with different people and in a different area with a different story.
So you didn't like any of the Harry, or you look, you lost interest halfway through the Harry Potter movies, just kind of.
And the books. Yeah. All of the above. Right.
Yeah. What was like the point where you're just like, oh my God, another, this wand and like the wizarding?
Oh dude, no, it was in the books. It was starting at the end of book four, when finally it's like, all right, we're not even going to pretend that we're just kids going to school. We're gonna fight a war, and you're
we're fighting a war now.
And then the beginning of book five is like, oh, Harry sure is being bullied at school again.
Oh my God, how annoying was that?
I was done.
So jacked. I was done. Don't at me. Book four is the best, and the movie number four is the best.
Agreed.
Like. It grabs all that stuff, and like, you're so right, because you think at book four you're like, God, we're so done with this, like, Harry has no friends at the beginning of school, and then he wins everybody's trust, and then at the end everyone loves Harry until they forget about it over the summer, and then Harry has no friends, and then he wins every,
yes,
like, and you're like,
yes,
oh God,
yes,
thank God in book four it's just like, the Olympics came to town. Let's do away with all the other crap. Like, now they're in the Olympics. And you're like, okay, Harry, of course, has to get written in for some random reason. And it's a nefarious thing. And then Cedric the fucko gets killed. And it's like, spoiler alert. And then you're like, oh, God, this is great. And Voldemort's back and he's killing kids. Oh, this is so metal. Harry Potter. And then you're so right. In that next book, it's like, Harry has no friends, and you're just like, fuck you.
Yeah, yep, nope, that's exactly 1,000,000,000% my exact reaction. And it was with the books, and then the movies were coming out, I was like, I'll try it. And then the movies, I'm like, I'm done, I'm out. I could, nope.
And like, literally the only excuse in the book and the movie is like, Harry's a teenager and he's very moody.
Yeah, no, it's, and plus all, you know, don't get me started. I don't want the whole internet to hate me, but fuck those books.
No, come on, let's embrace it.
No, fuck those books. Fuck those books and their lazy, half-assed, nope. Never mind.
It's fine. Come on.
I was fucking freebasing real fantasy back in high school. You gonna come at me with this fucking watered down shit about a kid riding a broom? Get the fuck out of my face! You go, explain to me what a hippogriff is. Like, I ain't been fucking rolling, summoning demons since I was a kid. But fuck you!
Like it's a book for children.
Yeah, I hope I catch the snitch!
The fucking dumbest game! Did she even read the words to the rules? Like it's so dumb that even LARPers who are play pretending Quidditch have to rejigger the rules. It's like they're reading one of the Gospels where just some insane shit is directly conflict, and they're like, well, if we massage it, and maybe the founders meant it this way when they wrote it, and it's like, I mean, the Snitch isn't really worth all the points in the world, because that would be a dumb game. There would be no point to the beating of the other bludgeons. Yeah, fuck this game. Fuck it. Hey, we got decks of cards.
Scamstuff.com.
Yeah, dude, scamstuff.com. We got Outlaws. I'm super, super proud of them. They're absolutely gorgeous. Bryce put together some amazing photography on them. They look great. They come in a puzzle box. You can get two of them and a challenge coin. The challenge coin looks amazing. Best design we've ever done. It's like this awesome sideways mashup. If you love stuff like the Dark Tower and Westworld and so on, archetypes of the gambler, the assassin, the knight, the shaman. It looks absolutely gorgeous. You're going to love it.
Dude, I'm getting it. I'm getting it right now. I'm going to buy it.
But seriously, fuck Quidditch, right?
I mean, like, it's a sport written by a fantasy writer, right? Where it's like, what does a fantasy writer need out of a sport? A way for their protagonist to win the game literally every time. So it's like, okay, so let's invent a way where at the end of every single game... Our hero
you're
just
gonna make me mad all over again. Mad all over again. See you next Tuesday.
Dying of fire. Night attack. Night attack. Night attack. Night
attack. I love you. Fuck Quidditch.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.